In this video, you'll learn all the basics of customizing the ASP.NET MVC grid view extension, starting from adding the extension into the project and binding it to data, to diving deeper into the overview of its settings. I have an MVC project here with a home controller and an empty index view. Let's run this and see what it looks like in the browser. Here you can see that the content area is empty. Let's return to Visual Studio. First, I'll add a data model, which I'll later bind to a DevExpress MVC grid view extension. I add an ADO.NET entity data model to the models folder. Select Generate from Database, click Next, define a new connection, click Next, and select the required table and click Finish. The model designer opens. I don't want to edit the data model, so I save it, build the solution, and close the designer. Now let's insert the grid view extension to the view. In the view, I right-click the position where I want to insert the DevExpress MVC grid view extension. Let's select the Insert DevExpress MVC extension item from the context menu, and the Insert Extension wizard opens. I navigate to Data and select the grid view. The wizard allows me to define the extension name and its partial view name. It also allows me to generate actions that handle callbacks related to creating, reading, updating, and deleting records within the grid view. In the Data Model section, I select the Automatically Generated Data Model class, the Entity Framework Data Context class, the columns I want to display, and the key field name. The Additional Settings section allows me to define whether or not to display a pager, group panel, or filter row. I click Insert, and the Insert Extension wizard generates all the necessary code for me. You can see that the view code has been changed. In the output window, I can see what files have been changed or created. Now let's take a look at the result in the browser. As you can see, the grid view appears and I can navigate through the pages using the built-in pager. Here you can see the filter row. If I want to find products with names beginning in CH, I can just type CH here and easily display the matching records. At the top of the grid, you can see the group panel that allows us to drag and drop columns onto it. So I'll drag the discontinued column here and all the records are grouped by this column. I can expand the group to access its underlying data rows, and rows that belong to one group can be displayed on different pages. I can also drag another column to the group panel and notice data rows within each group are arranged into second level groups based on the values of the new grouping column. We can click the column header and the rows will be sorted in ascending and descending order, and each column click reverses the sorting order. Plus, the grid view allows you to add, edit, and delete records. Let's take a look at the discontinued field, which is of type Boolean. It can be edited easily by typing true or false. Next, to reorder columns, I can easily drag a column header to a new position within the column header panel. Now let's return to Visual Studio and see what changes the wizard has generated for our project. In the Visual Studio output window, I'll select the output from the DevExpress extension integrator. Here I see the view code has been modified by the wizard. It has inserted a link to the partial view. I can double-click the output item and navigate to the changes directly. I can see that the actions have been added to the controller class. Here, you'll see that the wizard has already added the code that handles the create, update, and delete operations via the entity framework. Okay, so let's take a look at the partial view code and the controller code at the same time, side by side. The callback root values are handled by the grid view partial action from the home controller. The callback root values for the create, update, and delete operations are handled by the corresponding actions. Note that the wizard inserted all this code automatically, so I don't need to type this code manually. You can see that if an error in a create, update, or delete action occurs, then the error text will be passed to the view using the view data dictionary. And finally, the error text will be displayed within the grid view. Next, let's take a look at the grid view settings the wizard generated for us. The wizard defined the grid view's ID via the name property. Here are the callback root values for the create, read, update, delete operations. The grid view displays an edit form when editing a row. The grid view will display a confirmation dialog when an end user tries to delete a row. A command column with edit, new, and delete buttons will be displayed. The key field is product ID. The pager, group panel, and filter row are enabled, and end users can select a grid row by clicking on it. The wizard also added the required columns for display. And finally, the grid is bound to the data model. The grid view can be bound to any IEnumerable or IQueryable object. Okay, now let's add some more features to the grid. Let's modify the discontinued column. This column displays Boolean values, and it's not easy to type true or false when trying to change the column value, so I need to change the column type. The IntelliSense displays a list of possible column types for me. The checkbox is the best choice when displaying and editing Boolean values because it displays a visual element instead of requiring the end user to type in the value. The unit price column displays the currency values, so I change its display format string to C. Let's take a look at the list of available grid view settings. The grid view provides you with several settings for items like the grid view's behavior, cookies, editing, exporting, pop-ups, and more. I can also enable Microsoft Excel style filtering by setting the settings.show header filter button property to true. Now, let's display summaries in our grid view. Here you see the list of available summary types: average, count, etc. I select the count summary type and then define the name of the data field whose values will be used for summary calculation. Then I add a second summary item that calculates the average unit price. Finally, I enable the grid's footer because that's where the summaries are displayed. Let's take a look at the result in the browser. You can see that the total summaries are shown within the grid view. I've also added a header filter button, so it gives us all the unique values in each of the columns, and I can filter the grid view's rows against these values. The unit price column values are now displayed in the currency format. The grid renders the discontinued column values as checkboxes, so if I try to edit any record, I can just click the checkbox or edit the Boolean values. Note that the summary items update their value immediately when changing any row or the number of displayed rows. And that's it. Thanks for watching, and thank you for choosing DevExpress.